I was hoping you'd give me about 10 seconds more just to compose myself, but that's okay. I'm good to go. Good morning. So good to have you all here and see children with their backpacks all excited about school, and their excitement is only surpassed by the teachers who are so thrilled about going back to school. And really, the teachers that have retired are very excited. I know. I see you up there. So we're going to have a blessing of the backpacks. That will be during the time of the children's sermon. And if any parents just need a general blessing, you're welcome to come up and get one of those. A couple of other announcements. Today is the last Sunday to sign up for the ice cream social. Now, I just don't understand why everybody isn't signing up. We have a good crowd, but the rest of you need to sign up. I mean, this is eating ice cream on a hot summer Sunday afternoon. That's like America. That's what America does. So if you're patriotic, I expect to see you signing up to eat ice cream. It's not that hard to be an American. Sometimes you just have to follow the orders and the rules. We also have an insert about a endowment workshop, two endowment workshops that are upcoming, and I hope you'll pray about that and think about that and hopefully sign up for one of those. Our preschool is reopening this fall. We have a good group that signed up to begin preschool, and we have needs as we do every fall, and those needs are listed in the bulletin. And Liz, I believe you have a list posted somewhere.
Yes, actually just right outside where I see it. Currently our events for the day are. And it's a very colorful page, and it says preschool needs outside, and there, all you have to do is pull off a sticky note, and then you'll bring it back next week.
It's very inviting, and good things to keep our preschool well stocked during this year. Liz also is leading a meeting at 10 o'clock this morning with the parents of our children. We're going to be talking about Christian education opportunities for the fall. So we hope that you'll take just a moment, get a cup of coffee. And there's always coffee at a Lutheran church you can find. Get a cup of coffee and then come to that meeting and discuss what we've got upcoming and put your 2 cents worth in as well. I believe that is just about it. We'll update you on our hospital report at the time of the prayers of the church. We invite you to stand now as our service continues with the order for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever. Amen. Let us confess our sin now in the presence of God and of one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we long to take the best seats at the table. When met by those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life. Save us from ourselves and free us to love our neighbors. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Our opening song is You Are Holy.
You
That's a good Lutheran song. I like that. Let us pray. O God, judge eternal, you love justice and hate oppression, and you call us to share your zeal for truth. Give us courage to take our stand with all victims of bloodshed and greed, and following your servants and prophets, to look to the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
You might be seated. I invite the children forward for the children's message. Hey, girl, hey. I see that you're back from church life. Fun times. Oh, come sit with me, friends. I do have Abby's phone, so I got to keep my finger on it. Oh, come on, friends. Hey, hey, hey. Come on. Palmer, I just love your little Dotson dress. Do you know that Miss Liz's first doggy was a Dotson? Did I ever tell you that? His name was Rusty. He was such a cute little Dotson. Lucy, come this way. Come this way. Yay! She's like, nope. Nope. Hey, friends. How are you? Okay, let's try this again. Hey, friends. How are you? Okay, good deal. Hey, Charlie. You broke what? Oh, sweet bogey. You know, we had camp last week, and you guys weren't here at camp. And Mommy brought Bogey one day, because I was like, you know what? I need a little puppy in my life. And Bogey's such a sweet puppy. Although he really loves to bark. Loves to bark, like my doggies. Is he a sweet baby? Does he sleep in your bed, Asa? He sleeps with Mommy? Oh, yes, he does. Look, your mommy's saying, uh-huh, that little dog sleeps with me. I feel like that I have two dogs in my bed. You know, he sleeps in a cage. It's okay, crate train, crate train. All right, friends, who do you think we're going to talk about today? Jesus. We're going to talk about Jesus today. And actually, as we talk about Jesus today, do you know that one of Miss Liz's favorite texts is going to be read today? And in that favorite text, Pastor John, when he gets up to read to us out of the Bible, he is going to really talk about our great cloud of witnesses. Now, if you ever had a superpower, what do you think your superpower would be? Okay, you would fly. All right. Okay. What would your superpower be? To be invisible. Okay, Lucy, what's your superpower? You want to fly? She's like, yes. Yeah. Oh, what's your superpower, Blaney? Teleportation. Oh, my gosh. That's like a fifth grade word, Delaney. Wow, I know what grades you're going into. Okay, what's yours, Joe? What's your superpower, man? Making science experiments. That's so sweet. Like the Hulk, right? The Hulk was a science experiment. Okay, Asa, what would you be? You want to do science experiments too? Hey, I feel that. That's solid. That's solid. I think that I would want to read people's minds. Don't you think that would be so cool? Although I think it would be really noisy, right? Might be really noisy. Okay. Well, today, Pastor John is going to talk about, like, how we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. Do you know what that means? That means wherever we go, whatever we do, that the people who have gone on before us are around us all the time. For example, my mommy and daddy are in heaven, but I feel like that they're around me all the time. And they're around us because they are in our hearts, just like Jesus is, right? So Jesus is in our hearts. Our people are in our hearts. So everybody, even our great-great-great-great-grandfathers or our great-great-great-great-grandmothers, great-aunts, everybody. You have all these great cloud of witnesses. And do you know that they help us? They help us all the time. And not only do they help us, but they go with us. Charlie, out of all of our kids here, Charlie is goes to Rowan County School. So what did you do this week, Charlie? Okay, so Charlie headed back to school last Wednesday, and she really loves her teacher, Miss Deal. She told me that this morning. And in the next couple weeks, you all get to meet your new teachers too, right? And everybody is going to the next grade. So Charlie, what grade are you in?
Fourth.
You're in fourth grade. What grade are you going to be in? First grade. Wow, Delaney. Fifth grade, Delaney's going to be a middle schooler next year. How does that happen? Oh, my God. Joe, what grade are you going into? Are you going to kindergarten? Yeah? He's like, yeah, it takes me a minute to think about that. Ace, are you going back to school too? See, everybody's going back to school. And so today, I am going to bless you, and we are going to bless our teachers before we go. Because you know what? When we go out, our superpower really is Jesus, because Jesus goes with us. And what do I tell you all the time? Jesus is in our hearts, and when we leave this place, they know that we are Christians by our what?
Actions.
Well, by our actions and by our love. Yes, our love. And so I would say that our greatest superpower is the love of God in Christ Jesus. And I'll tell you whose we are. We are God's. We're Jesus's. And the Holy Spirit leads and guides us. So here's what we're going to do. So if you are a teacher or you are a student going back to school, I would like for you to stand up. Okay, y'all can stand up too. I'm going to stand up. Look, like a spry cat. Okay. Y'all need to stand up too because you're going back to school. Come on now. And if you are close to one of these people, you're going to put your hand on them, and I'm going to put my hand on these young people. Y'all come in front of me. Come on. Come so I can touch you. Come on. Oh, right here. Somebody take the camera out. Okay. Here we go. All right. So, today, we have before us our students, and our students will be carrying their backpacks to and from school, and of the children and youth who are gathered here. Your backpacks will contain work to be done, work to be returned, books to be studied, tools to complete homework, notebooks, pencils, pens, protractors, compasses, and other items for school. Someday so much stuff will fill backpacks that the students may find it difficult to walk. Other days, they will be light and nearly empty. But on each and every day, these backpacks represent work required of students gathered here. And as in every respect of our life, we bring these before God for a blessing at this time. Let us pray together. Gracious God, we lift you today. We lift these students and these teachers. They stand here ready to receive your blessings, and they commit themselves to study and learning in the school year ahead. We ask your blessings on each of them. Further, we ask your blessings on their backpacks. They will hold the school work of each teacher and students and will be carried from home to school and back again. As these students carry their backpacks, may they be reminded of the great love and care this congregation surrounds them with each school day. We pray for our teachers and our administrators in all of our schools. May they also be sustained by your blessing, and may they be reminded that this congregation embraces their call to teaching and learning and surrounds them with love and care. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who we seek to follow each and every day. And to that, we can say, can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right. I love you, friends. Okay, everybody get a bulletin and some crayons. I'll take, and look, I'm already standing up. Like, I don't even have to stand up. You, I love you.
The first reading comes from Jeremiah chapter 23, beginning with the 23rd verse. Because Jeremiah preaches the unpopular message of God's judgment, he suffers rejection. Today's reading distinguishes between the true prophet, like Jeremiah, who speaks God's word, and the false prophet who misleads the people through dreams. One is like wheat, the other like worthless straw. Now for the reading from Jeremiah. Am I a God nearby, says the Lord, and not a God far off? Who can hide in secret places so that I cannot see them, says the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth, says the Lord? I have heard what the prophets have said who prophesy lies in my name, saying, I have dreamed. How long will the hearts of the prophets ever turn back? Those who prophesy lies and who prophesy the deceit of their own heart. They plan to make my people forget my name by their dreams that they tell one another, just as their ancestors forgot my name for Baal. Let the prophet who has a dream tell them, but let the one who has my word speak faithfully. What has straw in common with wheat, says the Lord? Is it not my word like fire, says the Lord, and like a hammer that breaks a rock in pieces? Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading comes from the book of Hebrews, starting in chapter 11, verse 29. The author of Hebrews presents us with rich stories of faith. In a long list of biblical heroes, we find examples of trust in God that enabled them to face the trials of life faithfully. In addition to this cloud of witnesses, we have Jesus, the perfect model of faith endurance. Now for the reading from Hebrews. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as if it were dry land. But when the Egyptians attempted to do so, they were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after they had been encircled for 7 days. By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient, because she had received the spies in peace. And what more should I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David, and Samuel, and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, obtained promises, shut the mouth of lions, quenched raging fire, escaped the edge of sword, won strength out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead by resurrection. Others were tortured, refusing to accept release in order to obtain a better resurrection. Others suffered mocking and flogging, and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned to death. They were sawn in two. They were killed by the sword. They went out about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, persecuted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and holes in the ground. Yet all these, though they were commended for their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better so that they would not, apart from us, be made perfect. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. Word of God, word of life. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 12th chapter, and we say together, glory to you, O Lord. Jesus delivers harsh words about the purifying and potentially divisive effects of obedience to God's call. The way of the cross often leads followers to encounter hostility and rejection, even from those they love. Now for the reading from Luke's Gospel. Jesus said, I came to bring fire to the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. I have a baptism with which to be baptized, and what stress I am under until it is completed. Do you think that I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. From now on, 5 in 1 household will be divided, 3 against 2 and 2 against 3. They will be divided, father against son and son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He also said to the crowds, when you see a cloud rising in the west, you immediately say, it's going to rain. And so it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say, there will be scorching heat. And it happens. You hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time? This is the gospel of the Lord, and we say together, praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. I have a couple of radio stations around here that I really like. I've told you before, not to seem, you know, overly sophisticated and cultured, even though I am from Richmond County, which is one of course, the most sophisticated and cultured places in North Carolina. I've told you before that I can hear Mozart and know that it's Mozart. I recognize Bach. I appreciate Giuseppe Verdi. And I was in French Club in high school, and I know that Giuseppe Verdi really means Joe Green, which makes him a lot less intimidating when you think about that. But I have to tell you also that I really like the local oldie station. They play a lot of the Temptations. They play Archie Bell and the Drells from Houston, Texas. They play the Delphonics and the Rolling Stones and the Beatles. But because I'm a pastor, once or twice a year, because Deacon Liz lets me, I go on a youth trip. And for that week, the young people have control of the radio station in the van. And for hours, I listen to music that I don't understand. And I know you're old, many of you, and you don't understand it either, so I'm going to just give you a little thumbnail sketch of what your children and grandchildren are listening to. There is an attractive young woman named Dua Lipa, right? And she falls in love, and she is so infatuated that she just levitates. She just floats up out into outer space. She is so taken with the person she is dating, much like Anne did with me when we started dating. There's another pretty young woman named
Ariana, and she and this young man who calls himself The Weeknd. I don't understand how you name someone after 3 days, you know? I understand naming somebody Tuesday or Wednesday, but The Weeknd, they've had a tough go, but they are busy saving their tears for another day, which I thought it's not a bad thing to do. And Justin Bieber is doing, he's doing very well. He's got a lot of money in his pocket. If he wants peaches, he goes all the way to Georgia to get those peaches, yeah? He really does. And if he wants to take his girlfriend or his wife somewhere, they have enough money that even though he was in Georgia, he can now take her up north, yeah? And in between, it seems that he is buying something in California that I'm not sure is strictly legal, but that's where he goes, to California. Yeah. Now, when I'm with the youth, I just keep my mouth closed. I'm just the driver. I keep my eyes on the highway. And I also hear about movies on these trips. You can forget about John Wayne, and you can forget about Sean Connery. Superheroes are really big these days, and I've learned on these trips that there are Marvel superheroes like Spider-Man and Ms. Marvel and Thor, and then there are DC superheroes, folks like Batman and Wonder Woman and Aquaman. And you have to watch them in a particular order to get the most out of them. Now, kind of like we used to do with James Bond. I mean, you would never watch Diamonds Are Forever before you watched From Russia with Love. There's no continuity. So you watch Justice League before you watch Shazam. And that comes before Birds of Prey. You don't understand any of this, neither do I, but just remember that because you might need it someday. And you'll thank me if, you know, you're at a dinner party and people start talking about superheroes. You can appear very with it and very intelligent. Now, I don't know much about superheroes, but I am pretty impressed with the superheroes that Grace has told us about from today's reading in Hebrews. Grace told us all about these amazing things that they accomplished. By faith, the people passed through the Red Sea as if it were dry land. But when the Egyptians attempted to do so, they were drowned. That was Moses that brought that about. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after they had been encircled for 7 days. You can thank Joshua for that. By faith, Rahab the prostitute did not perish with those who were disobedient because she had received the spies in peace. You would think that maybe a prostitute wouldn't be a superhero, but that's not the case in Hebrews. She is lifted up to superhero status. And then what more should I say, the author says? I don't have enough time to tell you about Gideon and Barak, Samson, David and Samuel and the prophets. And through faith they conquered kingdoms, they shut the mouths of lions, they quenched raging fire. They escaped the edge of the sword. They became mighty in war. They put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead by resurrection. Now, this is a biblical understanding, as Liz told the children, of what superpowers are. It is relying on the power of God. It is relying on the presence of Christ in our heart and in our lives to do great things. These are people, these superheroes of the faith, who stand strong in the face of conflict and danger and disillusionment and fear. They are afraid because there is much to be afraid of. But the courage they get from Christ outweighs their fear. To face an uncertain future, not knowing what tomorrow will bring, but to march forward, believing and trusting that a loving God will be with us and will give us strength to meet whatever comes in this life. As Liz told us, that's a superpower. I want you to remember that today's epistle lesson was written to Christians who were undergoing terrible persecution at the hands of Nero, who was the Roman emperor. He was the one that threw Christians to lions. He was the one that had them burned at the stake and tortured on the rack. And in the face of such terrible persecution, a lot of Christians gave up. They turned their back on Jesus and began to fall away. They began to doubt God's existence and God's loving care for them. Things were so hard that they began to think that God had maybe forgotten them, or even worse, that God had forsaken them. And nothing has changed. This is still a hard place to live, isn't it? And there are times when all of us feel forsaken and forgotten and alone. When I was at Duke, I was surrounded by a lot of Methodists who I learned are basically good people. But I learned that if you are a new Methodist pastor in the United States, you have the ability, there's an arrangement worked out between United States Methodists and Methodists in Great Britain, you have the ability to go to England and to serve a couple of years there. They want young pastors. So my friend Steve, 40 years ago, was young. And he was single and he was up for adventure. And he was Methodist. And so he took advantage of this opportunity and he signed on the dotted line. He arrived in England. He spent a couple of weeks in training with the other clergy. And then he found himself on a train headed into the British countryside for an appointment in a tiny little English village. Steve was from Spring Hope, North Carolina. And England was a long way from home. Steve had never actually been on a train before. And he told me that he knew he was somewhere foreign when he went to breakfast the first morning and they ate pork and beans for breakfast. He said, you know, we never did that in Nash County. He said, we ate Eastern-style barbecue pretty much any time of day, but we did not eat pork and beans for breakfast. And he told me that he was struggling with a combination of homesickness, hunger, and fear. And the longer the train ride lasted, the more worried he became, and he began to think, what in the world was I thinking when I signed up to do this for 2 years? And then God gives you a sign. And he was looking out the window of the train, and there was this huge billboard that said, take courage. Take courage. As I told you, Steve was a Methodist from Nash County, and the first thing he thought was, that'll preach. Take courage. And he knew he had his sermon for the upcoming Sunday. And so on Sunday morning, he stood up before his congregation and he told them about his fear and his anxiety and his doubt. And then he told them about seeing that wonderful sign, take courage. And when he told this story, he noticed that the younger people in the church smiled. Some of them actually laughed, and a few of them gave him a thumbs up. The older people, at first, they looked confused and surprised, but then as the sermon illustration went on, they didn't seem very pleased at all with it. Steve was undaunted, just like a good Methodist, and he drove his point home. When any of us is afraid, when any of us are afraid, when we're lonely, when we're lost, all we need to do is take courage and have faith, and God will certainly see us through. After the service, the lay leader came up to Steve and told him that courage was actually a British beer. And that what he had seen on the billboard was a beer advertisement. And the lay leader then told him that he should remember he was in a British Methodist church, so most of the older folks were absolute teetotalers. Now, the young people felt an immediate affinity with him. Several of the older women reached in their purses and pulled out old yellowed prohibition cards that they had signed 60 years earlier when they were in their 20s. Fortunately, Steve made it through that first Sunday, mostly because he and his new parish did take courage. The other kind of courage, the kind of courage that doesn't come in a can. And they had faith. They had faith in each other, and they had faith in the God who had brought them together. And Steve told me that it was two of the most wonderful years of his life. The writer of Hebrews reminds us this morning that the secret to a strong life is to hold on to God and to prepare ourselves for whatever life may send our way. I'm a firm believer in the fact that as Christians, we ought to always expect the best. There are a lot of Christians today who have forgotten that. We are not an abandoned people. And this is not an abandoned world. This is a world that God loved enough to come and visit in person. And God's Spirit is still here. So I think that changes the way that we ought to think about the world and the way we ought to think about the future. You and I ought to be positive and expect the best. But should life deal us a terrible blow, we are to be prepared. We are to have courage and faith and to hold on to God, who promises above all things never to let us go. So what does it take to be a real superhero? It means that we strive to walk in the footsteps of Jesus. It means never giving up, no matter what life throws at us. And it means not only serving God, but serving others, knowing that God has called on us to make this a better world. And so may God give each of us strength as we walk together this journey of life. Thanks be to God for that opportunity. Amen.
with the people of God in Christ now and in every time, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come near to the Holy One in prayer. You're invited to kneel or be seated as able for the prayers of the church. I will tell you as we're preparing to pray that Peggy Pergola had successful surgery on her hand, which has been plaguing her for some time. She is recuperating at home. Doug Brothers of our congregation remains a patient at Atrium Cabarrus as they're trying to work on medication for his blood pressure to get it at the level that it needs to be. There's a chance that he may come home today, but he also may stay another day. So Doug requests your prayers, and certainly he has them. Arise, O God, and sustain your church. We pray for all who dedicate their lives to serving your people. Renew our commitment to our siblings in faith around the world, and bless the work of all churches. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Arise, O God, and sustain the nations. We pray for all elected officials, wherever they may be. Kindle in them a desire to administer your justice. Strengthen their resolve to defend those who are vulnerable and to stand publicly against all forms of oppression. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Arise, O God, and sustain those who are oppressed. We pray for people who are harmed by discrimination. Rescue us from all systems that degrade our fellow human beings and make them seem less than your children. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, we remember all of the saints who have gone before us, and we think of them now in the silence of this moment. We pray for Doug and for Peggy and for all who have special needs this morning. And we ask, O Lord, that we might run with perseverance the race that is set before us until we find our rest in you. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Receive the prayers of your children, merciful God, and hold us forever in your steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, our holy wisdom. Amen. Let us stand together. Melissa, I'm going to ask you to use your teacher voice and tell us who your guests are this morning. Wonderful. We are so glad to have you. And we pass the peace really well in this congregation. So you're going to have people coming up to you, shaking your hand, and you know, telling you that we don't eat baked beans for breakfast, but we got barbecue. So we hope that you will have a very good experience here. Following his resurrection, the Lord Jesus breathed peace upon his disciples. We share in this peace of Christ in the church today. The peace of the Lord be with you. Let us share God's peace with one another. Been about 10 seconds behind all morning. Let us pray. God of abundance, you have set before us a plentiful harvest. As we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your field and equip us to bear fruit for the good of all. In the name of Jesus, amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. Broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for them to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered as one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. It is a good thing to remind us each and every Sunday that all are welcome at the Lord's table. So if you are a communing member of your church, or if you desire to take communion here with us today, please know that you are welcome. In Christ's presence, there is fullness of joy. Come to the banquet. For those who have received the elements earlier, or those who are communing at home, you may receive the bread and the wine as these words are said. This is the body of Christ given for you. And this is the blood of Christ shed for you. You may be seated.
Here we are, joy.
Let us stand. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Now receive this benediction. Before we do the benediction, I'll just remind the congregation about the items for preschool that are located right here in the narthex, and also for parents of our children about the meeting that's coming up at 10 o'clock with Liz, and that will be down in the commons area, just where folks are gathering. That's where we'll be. Now may the God of peace, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you, comfort you, and show you the path of life this day and always. Amen. Our sending song is Better Is One Day.